Today, we are gonna take this PC and overclock, overvolt, or otherwise run beyond the manufacturer's specifications every single part of it that we can. Some of the stuff we're gonna do will seriously improve performance, and some of it definitely won't. Big shout out to Seasonic, by the way, for sponsoring this craziness. Let's get started. So it shouldn't be news to most of you that the first thing you need when you're overclocking is a solid power supply. Inadequate or unstable power can adversely affect stability, so we chose the Seasonic Prime Titanium Fanless, a seriously cool unit that is literally silent because it has no fan. So it's the first thing that we're going to tune by plugging it into one of the 208 volt power outlets in the other unit. So we're running on 120 volt right now, sucking about 270 watts. Let's see what happens here. All right, so after a quick cable swap here for this beefy extension cord running out of the other room, we're running at about 190 volts. So there was some voltage drop. And our same stress test is now between 255 and 260 watts. This doesn't make anything faster, but it does improve your system's efficiency. Though, probably not enough that I would, if you're in North America, like run out and get 200 volt power put into your house. Now before doing anything else, you're gonna want your motherboard's latest BIOS, so you can see ours is so new that it has little animations in here. You're also going to want the latest OS updates and a handful of tuning utilities. Then you want to get some baseline readings in your preferred performance tests so you can make sure that any efforts you're making, any dials that you're turning, are actually doing something and that what they're doing is positive. Now, we've done more detailed CPU overclocking guides in the past, so we're gonna skip over some details here, but basically, by adjusting our CPU multiplier to 51 and disabling SVID, we were able to get our Core i5-8600K from 4.3 gigahertz on all cores to 5.1 gigahertz with all cores active at 1.275 volts. So that's only a 0.005 volt increase, and it yields a 20% or higher improvement in our CPU tests. So we are off to a very good start. Now, this is usually where we stop tooling around with the processor, because CPU cache overclocking doesn't really help much outside of very memory intensive applications. But not today. After getting your CPU core dialed in, you can actually start upping the cache until it's at a similar frequency to the core or until it causes stability problems. So ours was able to go from 4 to 4.8 gigahertz with a little bit more CPU voltage, which actually did manage to give us a measurable boost in Cinebench. Now, when it comes to RAM overclocking, we generally recommend staying away from XMP or other auto memory overclocking, since while sometimes it works, so it can be worth a shot, other times it can be questionably stable. As for our kit, well, it's rated at 3200 megahertz, and our overclocking result was 3200 megahertz, even with extra voltage. So we didn't technically overclock our RAM, but we did overclock our system past the JEDEC DDR4 spec, so yeah. We got an extra 27 points in Cinebench, so we're gonna call that a success. From there, we did actually try fine-tuning the base clock of the system as well, but especially given that we already had everything else like tuned to the red line, it wasn't having any of it. This whole thing is on the knife's edge of stability as it is. So then with all of the tuning we've done so far, what do we get for our trouble? How has this affected our gaming experience? Ooh. Turns out we've netted a whopping 1.2% increase in 3DMark TimeSpy and a whole 2 FPS in Far Cry 5. So, it might be time to overclock our graphics. My preferred strategy for this is MSI Afterburner in the foreground so we can make any adjustments that we'd like, and some kind of stress test running in windowed mode in the background so we can monitor stability. So you fire up Afterburner, grab that there power knob, and rip it all the way to the max. In our case, it's like 112%. Ooh, some older GPUs do let you go higher. Then you incrementally increase the core clock until the system becomes unstable. So we landed on 150 megahertz for our core. For our memory clock, we ended up with +275, so you do that right after your core, and this gave us more than a 10 frame per second increase in Rise of the Tomb Raider. Although, everything else hardly changed for some reason. That's kind of weird, why is that? Well, as it turns out, NVIDIA's GPU Boost 3 was already turboing the card up close to 2 gigahertz without our adjustments. That's much higher than the advertised 1683. That's because the cooling capabilities of this card are able to sustain it. So that means that without overclocking, you're actually getting close to the maximum performance you'd be able to out of a modern card like a 1070. Which is great for most people, but overclockers without BIOS modding and like physically modifying the card to apply more voltage to the GPU don't get a lot of performance gains to brag about. So up until now, everything has been like a Nanaimo bar. Just goodness. But there has been one downside. Thermals. So under full load, our processor, for instance, is about 15 degrees Celsius hotter. But what could we overclock to make the computer cooler? What if we were to give more voltage to the fans? So stashed in here, where a hard drive would normally go, is something pretty special. This is a DC to DC converter. So all we do is plug standard Molex 12 volt into this side, then Alex is gonna adjust this little potentiometer here. Go for it, nice! Whoa, can you hear that? Now we've got 17 volts coming out the other side, which is where we have our fans attached. So in IDA 64, what kind of an improvement will we see? Bam! CPU temps down to 69 degrees, a 7-degree improvement. And all we had to give up was sound, since this guy went from like, I don't know, 20 decibels or so? We're not sure, since it was below the sound floor of our office, thanks in part to the fanless power supply, up to 55 decibels, which is around a normal conversation or an air conditioner. This also, by the way, won't help the lifetime of your fans. Our Noctuas actually might be fine, but cheaper ones will likely end up letting out the magic blue smoke before long. So I think pretty much everything inside the case is overclocked now. But what about the things outside it? Like your mouse and your keyboard and your monitor. Can they be overclocked? Yes. Yes, they can. Okay, so for your mouse, the polling rate in Windows is 125 hertz, meaning that there can be up to 8 milliseconds of lag between moving your mouse and it registering, which can lead to noticeable delays in fast-paced games. In Windows 7, it was possible to overclock the polling rate on your USB ports, which could be great if your mouse sensor could handle it. But Windows 8 and up have changed the way that USB drivers work, and this is no longer possible. Fortunately, a lot of gaming mouse manufacturers have found ways to solve this problem for you, since most of them default to 500 hertz, and you can use mouse rate to check yours for yourself. So click and move your mouse around. Bippity boppity, this is gonna max out at 500. There you have it. Now, with that said, we can go higher. This final mouse right here has a firmware tool that you can grab. We get one crack at this, by the way, so, and run to flash it to a 1,000 hertz firmware. And then other mouse manufacturers like Corsair and Razer have software tools that work similarly. Let's just let this finish up and then we'll see if it worked. Hey, success! Oh, I can't even move it fast enough to get all the way to 1,000. Okay, whatever, it's definitely over 500. As for keyboards, this is largely dependent on the manufacturer. So this Corsair one can actually be adjusted with this switch that's right on the back of it. Bear in mind, of course, that the reason they make this so easy is that it can affect compatibility with your system. Other keyboards may not be possible to overclock at all. Moving on to the monitor, overclocking this is actually super easy. If you've got an NVIDIA card, all you need to do is go into Change Resolution right here, then click Customize. Tick Enable Resolutions Not Exposed by the Display, and create yourself a custom resolution accepting all of the terms and conditions and warnings that come along with it. From here, all you gotta do is dial in a new refresh rate, then click Test. Even a small increase over 60 hertz, like going to 70 or 75, should make a very noticeable difference in games if you've got the GPU horsepower to drive it. Now, there ended up being a few things that you can't overclock, like your SSD or your hard drive. Like, if you've got a 7200 RPM disk, that's all she's got. And the closest thing would be buying a faster drive in the first place, like a WD Velociraptor that spins at 10,000 RPM. But like even that is much slower than an SSD. Also, we tried pretty hard to get the webcam overclocked. And while it's technically possible to increase the FPS while decreasing the resolution, our Logitech unit just wouldn't play ball. Now, I was really on the fence about including this, but Alex insisted that we include one last thing that you can overclock, and it's probably the slowest thing about your computer. You. If you don't touch type, learn to touch type. Also, learn all of the keyboard shortcuts that you can, and if you're doing the same operation often enough, many modern keyboards allow you to program it as a macro key. You only have to press one button to execute it. And there's a joke here, it's terrible. Since, although you can't stop AI and machines from taking over, maybe you can use these tips and tricks to stay useful for a little bit longer. So a big thanks to Seasonic for sponsoring this video. It's pretty freaking cool that they were able to make a 600 watt power supply with literally zero noise. And that they were cool with us then putting a super loud system around it. Thanks for watching, you guys. If this video sucked, you know what to do, but if it was awesome, get subscribed, hit that like button, or check out the link to where to buy the stuff we featured in the video description. Also down there is our merch store, which has cool shirts like this one, and our community forum, which you should totally join. All we've gotta do, you're in, you got it. Oh, you're not in.
Yeah, not quite.
Dang it, Alex.
Like close to N.
Okay, you gotta finesse it, okay? You just gotta get the pins kinda in there, and then you gotta...
Yeah, you're not in yet.
You know what? You'll know when I'm in.
Well, yeah.